Whether it's a hot time in Florida or a rainy night in Georgia,
living with trouble,
it's the perfect time for the TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis fan podcast.
Oh, yes, sir. Good to see you, folks. This Bad Fix Spring is the hottest thing in the country. Real hot and blue. Coming to WHB in Memphis, Tennessee.
Welcome to TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis Presley fan podcast. I'm Justin Gosman, and this week we are joined by a very special guest. Welcome to the show, Garrett Cash.
Howdy, everybody.
Garrett, welcome to TCB Cast. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. It's another really, really hot day here in Central Florida, so...
Absolutely. Now, you've been listening to the show for a while, and we've touched base a number of times over the last few years, but it's so nice to actually get to sit down and talk with you and do an episode with you. And, of course, you're a massive Elvis fan. I got to ask you, how did you become an Elvis fan?
So, excuse me, when I was a boy, I had my father's really into music, and he's always been involved in the music world in some way, writing for music magazines, going to lots of shows. He has a big CD collection. So I knew that there was music around me, but I didn't take any particular interest in it until I was around 8 years old. Up till that point, I had mostly just played sports and whatnot. Like, I thought that the only thing that guys could do is either be interested in the military or being in a sports team of some kind. So, you know, I figured sports was the less dangerous option. So in some way. So I did that. And at one point, I was also in the Boy Scouts, and I went to go stay overnight in the USS Yorktown in Charleston, South Carolina. And my cousin had recently purchased his first CD that he was very excited for me to hear. And it was the Beatles One compilation that had just come out.
Oh, yeah.
And so he played that, and it basically just unlocked this part of my mind that has never, it's just been a Pandora's box in my whole life ever since, that I just became obsessed with, music of this era. And I loved the Beatles, and I was walking around in a library not too long after that, and I saw these books that were in the kind of children's biography section that were Elvis like biographies of Elvis, like written like for kids, and I thought, you know, I've seen Elvis usually in some kind of nostalgia shop setting. Like, I'd been in like a McDonald's that had like murals of Marilyn Monroe and Elvis and like Happy Days, Fonzie type stuff all over it.
Oh yeah.
And so I kind of thought of Elvis as like this, you know, just greaser guy who sang back in the 50s. And I didn't know anything about him other than that. And so I thought, oh, well, I'll learn something about Elvis. So I started reading this book. And I thought that the story was really interesting. I had no idea that, you know, he was this, you know, poor kid from the South that changed the world. And I asked my dad, I said, do we have any Elvis CDs? Because I know you got tons of CDs. And he was like, well, yeah, of course I do. You know, do you think I'm a heathen? You know, like, of course I got Elvis CDs. So I started listening to them. And I mean, it was just like hearing the Beatles CD was for me. It was just this mind-blowing moment hearing Heartbreak Hotel and stuff like that for the first time. And not too long after that, I went to a record store, and this was also where a Pandora's box of my life, because I own around like 3,000 records right now, so, you know, this is not a problem at all. But so, you know, I went to a record store for the first time. The first record I ever bought was Blue Hawaii by Elvis. And, you know, now I own every Elvis studio album and pretty much every compilation and live album and all that kind of stuff. And it's just one of those things where, you know, one little thing starts and it just keeps growing over time.
It snowballs.
Yep, exactly. And I'm very happy to say that after years of wanting to go to Graceland and this kind of being my main thing that I try to convince my family every time we were going to do vacation, I'd be like, why don't we go to Memphis, Tennessee? My wife did take me to Memphis the first maybe year or so after we had gotten married. She had heard me talking about it enough and finally just thought she would, you know, make me shut up about it and finally take me. So I have been to Memphis at least once now to see Graceland. I still don't think that you have, Justin, but I have been to Graceland. So Yep, that that pretty much sums it up. Of course, you know, that led to all the Sun Rockabillys and all the other various interests and paths my life has taken has pretty much been the Beatles and Elvis.
Fantastic. And folks, if you might be familiar with Garrett and his voice, it would probably be if you also listen to Nate Wilcox's Let It Roll podcast, because as you know, Nate does a number of sub-series on his show diving into different genres of music, and he's done ones on country music, he's done ones on hip-hop music, I think he's got one on metal, but you actually are working with him and have been working with him on a series on American gospel music.
Yes, and Elvis was the path that I discovered gospel music through, because one of those first record shopping trips I went on, I acquired a copy of His Hand in Mine, which, you know, I saw him looking so reverent and sitting at the piano on the actually, the version I bought was the one with his face like kind of disembodied up in the heavens in the sky.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, and I've still got that one in addition to my original. And that I was like, wow, you know, this guy who did like rock and roll and all these like songs about cars and girls and stuff did gospel music too. Like the only, you know, Christian music that I knew was the worship music I heard in church on Sunday and the alternative Christian rock that my parents played. I didn't really know anything about gospel music. And so that just totally opened up that whole world of gospel quartets and black gospel music and started a whole passion for that. And so, yeah, me and Nate have really tried to recenter the narrative of American roots music to include gospel as being one of the primary musical works of greatness that America has produced and has been a huge building block for other stuff. But I don't even like to refer to gospel as just being like a foundation for something else better or something like that. I think gospel is the better thing most of the time. But it has been a remarkable influence on so many people and so many genres, but it is genuinely perfect and great in and of itself as well. And I think that we've been just trying to open people's eyes and ears to just how great that music is and how deep that well is, and that most people have never even heard of the biggest artists in that genre. So that's been something we've been proud of, to try to shine a light on people like Marianne Williams or Sister Rosetta Tharpe and Mahalia Jackson, people like that.
Yeah, it's been a fantastic listening experience getting to hear you and Nate go through that, because similarly, like I've talked before about me becoming an Elvis fan and going through, you know, like Last Train to Memphis or stuff like that. And you see all these proper nouns and these names and places and songs, and if you've never heard it and have no frame of reference, you have no idea what it is. And it's only if you seek that stuff out later that you start connecting the dots. And there are certainly people that you guys have covered on, and I haven't even said the name of the sub like show, because it's all under the banner of Let It Roll. But I love the name that you guys picked for the series. It's called Holy Roll. Which is such a great wordplay.
And it was originally gonna, like, we were just calling it, like, you know, gospel roll or something, and then I think Nathan one day was just like, wait a minute, we have to call this Holy Roll. And then I was like, yep, we definitely do.
It's so amazing. But there's definitely been artists and individuals and stories that you guys have covered on that have opened my eyes, things that I had not thought of or paid attention to. Some of which we're going to talk about today when, as we get through our main topic. And it's because of Holy Roll that I actually thought to ask and reach out to you about doing a very special mini-series for TCBCast on Elvis and country music. And that's why we're here today. So we have a lot of information to get to as we go through, but I did want to at least ask for your story of how you became an Elvis fan. And we'll certainly talk about your history with country music. But I think it's obvious to longtime listeners of the show that this is something that I've been wanting to do for a very long time. Gurdeep, infamously not a huge country music fan. And
my current boss at my job, when I asked him, so what kind of music do you like? He said, well, I like pretty much everything except that sad sack country music where it sounds like they're like crying in a beer or something. I just like quietly faded into the background after that, just tried to act like that wasn't some of my favorite music or anything like that.
And that's really the thing that I hope that we are able to do for listeners of TCBCast and anyone who actually finds this, is introduced to the series, maybe through this this miniseries as well. But it's to make you think about Elvis Presley's music and his connections to country music in a completely new light, or at least a slightly new light. And we have a lot of notes. You and I have been frantically late nights going through and updating and just digging in, sending each other songs and recordings and tidbits of information just we had an amazing moment of synchronicity recently where you sent a clipping about a song and I sent the song within 2 seconds.
it was at the exact same time. It was pretty that was pretty weird, uncanny.
Yeah. But over the course of this month, we're going to be releasing all of the episodes that we've been working on through this whole time. It's going to be as of right now, starting recording this, I think it's going to be a 4-part series. That's what we've been talking about. This first part is going to talk about Elvis's country roots and, of course, the 1950s era of Elvis Presley. Episode 2 will focus on the 1960s and the Nashville sound. Episode 3 will naturally feature the 1970s and Elvis's return to popularity within the genre of country music, actually having charting hits with country music again, and leading up to his untimely and unfortunate passing. And then the 4th episode will be a postscript talking about the influence of Elvis on country music posthumously, which is going to be a lot of fun because I think there's going to be some stuff in there that people maybe haven't heard about or thought about. So let's go ahead and start with Garrett. What's your history with country music? Where did you start out at?
I'd say that the first country artist that I heard and liked and would have called myself a fan of was Johnny Cash. And other than that, I wasn't really aware of what was country music and what wasn't, I guess. Like, I liked Riders in the Sky, the group that did the Western songs for Toy Story 2, which is a movie that I loved growing up. Still, it's a great film.
Yeah.
Wood is Roundup, right here every day. Wood is Roundup, come on, it's time to play. There's Jessie, the yodeling cowgirl. He's Woody's horse.
He's a smart.
Pete the old prospector. And Woody the man himself. Of course it's time for Woody's Roundup.
I knew I loved Western music. I was really into singing cowboys like Gene Autry and Roy Rogers, Sons of the Pioneers. I liked all that stuff a great deal. But as far as like country music went, Hank Williams and the like and all that, couldn't say that I was familiar with it just because my dad at that time was a lot more into 80s new wave alternative, 90s alternative, yeah, stuff like that. He grew up in Georgia in the 70s and whatnot. And I think that he just kind of had these like kind of old associations in his mind of country and Southern rock with these kind of like redneck kids at his school and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And so he didn't really play a whole lot of that stuff at the time. And as I'm saying that, it's just funny to me because now he's like just as diehard a fan of Hank Williams and Bob Wills and all that as I am. But we didn't hear a whole lot of it growing up, but I did like Johnny Cash, and there was this moment where I realized, oh wait, you know, Hank Williams is the guy that did Moving On Over. I like George Thorogood Moving On Over, so maybe I should listen to more Hank Williams, and then things like that start snowballing.
I come in last night about 10:30, that baby of mine wouldn't let me in.
Moving on over.
lock on our front door. My door key don't fit no more, so get it on over.
Move it on over.
Scoot it on over.
Move it on over.
Move over, skinny dog, cause the fat dog's moving in.
So I guess that's maybe the best place to start, the fact that even your father and certainly a lot of people who aren't growing up with country music and don't sort of have it just like ingrained in their musical DNA like I had. Like I grew up, you know, kid of the 90s, so I was growing up with all of the hits at that time, and we were fortunate enough to have a locally owned country station in our hometown. And so they would not necessarily just be restricted to playing what was popular, you know, what were current hits. We would still get classic country music from the 50s, 60s, 70s, up to, you know, the 80s and 90s, what was more recent hits at the time. And that love of country music has continued forward. And so to me, it's always just been sort of a natural appeal to it. And certainly that was helped along by having parents or my mom and my grandparents who had a love of country music as well. And growing up in rural South Dakota, relating to a lot of the themes and messages that were in country music in a very personal way. Having come from a family that, you know, had a farm back, you know, they settled in South Dakota, you know, 120 years ago now at this point or whatever. And so you would hear the stories of, you know, grandparents growing up on the farm and things like that. To me, it's been interesting to interact with Elvis fans who are like Gurdeep, who grew up in a very urban environment, or people who are fans who are not American and don't really have the frame of reference of country music or don't see the or understand the appeal of country music naturally, and why it's significant that Elvis be considered part of the continuity of country music and the history of country music. Because there is certainly a resistance, I think, even within the country establishment, to accept Elvis Presley as a large part of the history of country music. I think the general gist of how they sort of view him is that he was really important in the 50s when he was, you know, Louisiana Hayride, Sun Records, and a little bit when he started RCA. And then once he got into the really, you know, hit rock and roll stuff, well, then he was too big for country music. And then he's not really relevant to country music after that point. Does that sound right to you?
Yeah, I would say in general, if anybody even knows anything at all about Elvis or his career and whatnot, I don't think any of them would necessarily say that Elvis plays any sort of a major part in the country music story, which is just, you know, a hilarious misconception when you actually start looking into it. And we're going to talk about it. But yeah, I think that most people really just view it as being that Elvis used country music as a launch pad to get his own vision and style of music off the ground when there was no previous way for somebody like him to be able to do what he was going to do, because there was no rock and roll charts. There was no rock and roll, you know, magazines. There wasn't a rock and roll separate world yet. So he had to kind of use the country music world, because, I mean, he wasn't black. He couldn't use the R&B world. So he has to use the country world to springboard off of to become a superstar doing this new kind of music, I think, is the way most people view it.
Yeah, there's almost like, I don't think I've ever heard anyone express this outright, but there's like an undercurrent of maybe thinking that it was a little cynical, you know, Elvis, you know, having to come in through country music because that was the only way that he could do, kind of like you were saying, and then not really being country. You know, the one quote that you pointed out to me that I thought was really pointed in Ken Burns' wonderful documentary, Country Music, that came out, when did that come out?
2019.
It's been a long few years.
It has. That really feels like a year or two ago to me.
I know, same. But in discussing the Grand Ole Opry and Johnny Cash at the Opry, there's an apocryphal story that's not sourced and it doesn't identify the person who says it, but they say of Johnny Cash, he'll be better than Elvis because Johnny's a true country singer and Presley isn't and never has been.
Yeah.
it was just like that in a nutshell sums up what country has often thought of Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
And what I want to do to start off is we're going to try to arm our listeners with an understanding of what country music is comprised of and where it comes from, because you really have to understand where country music came from and its traditions and all of the sounds to really understand why it's significant to think of Elvis within that continuity. So I hope that as we go through this, there'll be things that certainly we'll have people who listen or are huge country music fans. There won't be a single thing we say that they haven't heard before, but I hope that for most of our listeners, there'll be at least a few things that they've never heard before. Some few songs that they've never heard before, some artists, some names that they've never heard of or thought of before, and maybe challenge some preconceived notions of what country music even is, you know, because oftentimes there is sort of this looking down your nose at country music. You know, it's very common to hear people go, I don't like country music except for Johnny Cash and Dolly Parton.
Or I like all kinds of music except country or rap.
Right.
I'm like, you just took out like two of the biggest genres that there are. So you only like rock and jazz and classical? Like, you know, what's going on here?
So, yeah, let's go ahead and start, I guess, by learning the language and the lineage of the sounds of country music, because there's so much about what's stereotypically country music today. We're so deep into the genre that it almost feels like certain things have just always been there, you know, things like a banjo or a fiddle. But we got to talk about where those things come from, because they play a factor in how we understand country music. And of course, the biggest one by far is, of course, Appalachian folk music, which is music from the British Isles, from Scotland, from Ireland, from Wales. It's traditional folk songs carried over by immigrants to America.
I went one night to her sister's house about 8 o'clock at night, and I asked her for to take a walk, our wedding day to pine. We walked along quite merrily till we came to level ground. Then I pulled a stake out from the edge and I knocked this fair one down. And down upon her bended knees, she pleaded for her life. Oh, Johnny dear, don't kill me here. I am not prepared to die.
Yeah, and this was an interesting thing about my discovery of country, was that I really had no idea it was kind of a part of my own, like, family history, because my family history is of Scottish immigrants. My last name is Cash. I am related to Johnny, not like, you know, he's not my granddad or anything, but I mean, it is close enough that I'm like a distant cousin removed something or another. And, you know, I've got this whole Scottish background thing, and that kind of opened up this whole aspect of it to me, which was that the songs that these people are singing are songs that they knew either before they came over to America, or their parents did, or their grandparents did, and they just keep singing the same songs, and then they change a little bit over time. Like, for instance, if you live in Knoxville, Tennessee, you may be singing the old song Wexford Girl, but now you live in Knoxville, so you're just going to call it Knoxville Girl.
I met a little girl in Knoxville, a town we all know well. And every Sunday evening, out in her home at Will, we went to take an evening walk about a mile from town. A stick up off the ground and knocked that fire girl down. She fell down on her bended knees, for mercy she did cry. Oh, Willie dear, don't kill me here, I'm unprepared to die.
You know, so things like that will happen over time where you're Americanizing the old ballads and the actual old Scottish ballads as played by people who play old music and whatnot. It sounds remarkably the same, like the instrumentation and all that. Like it just sounds like people in the hills in America singing with kind of just a Americanized in terms of the lyrics way of doing these European ballads when you first start out.
Yeah, and it's worth talking about that there was a wave of immigration that came. I think they call them the Scotch-Irish. And it was primarily from, I think, the Ulster region of Ireland. There was a big wave, and Elvis Presley's ancestors were part of this wave of immigrants that moved initially to the American Northeast. And then because of the crowding up there in the American Northeast, sort of trickled their way down south and up into the hills. And that's where you get into places like Tennessee, Kentucky, the Carolinas, West Virginia, you know, the deep south. And what you were talking about there about them bringing the music from home and changing some of the lyrics and just sort of modernizing it. At the time, there's this streak in country music of wanting to have nostalgia for the days gone by, even if oftentimes the days gone by that you're singing about is something that you actually never experienced. It's the nostalgia for an idealized point in the past. And oftentimes it's singing about, family members and the lived experience of what it was like to just be those people, and to sing of the places back home and the things you used to do. It's all the same things that people have always made music for throughout human history. It's to dance, it's to worship, to entertain yourself, to keep yourself occupied while you're working, to fall in love to. It's just a human expression. And along those same lines, we have to talk about one of the other hugest influences on the history of country music, and that is West African traditional music and the music of the enslaved African Americans, who brought their own music from their homes with them when they were forcefully taken.
Yep, and this is another situation where you have people bringing music with them to a new land, but of course in a much more disgusting and reprehensible situation. And the music that they brought over, when we were doing research for the Let It Roll about the enslaved spirituals and whatnot, it was remarkable. They were talking about, the scholars were talking about how that music, really it was not a given that that music would survive, the music that they brought with them from Africa to America, but that it was a part of their strength and their resilience and their hope that they carried with them, that they not only kept the music intact and kept singing it and kept the music alive, but that they would often continue to play with and shape the music in new ways, just like I was talking about with the Appalachian Mountain people, that they would change lyrics and whatnot. The same thing was true of the enslaved, was that they would change words of old songs to talk about their masters or, the places that they lived in or, people that they knew. And they would change words of like old worship songs that weren't about the Christian God into ones that were. So there's just all kinds of things like that where you see both the, like you said, the propensity for nostalgia that a lot of people would use as a comfort tactic to try to remember the good old days. And you would also have this great outpouring of creativity and of imagination and of pioneering something new while you were also being nostalgic.
Also, one thing that you hear commonly in the history of both the music of white and black folks in those eras is that it was also a way that people would share news and current events, because oftentimes, you had folks who couldn't read or didn't have the same lines of communication that people in larger urban areas had. And so songs themselves would become important ways of sharing information and spreading information and messages.
Yes, and you can still see that even at the dawn of commercial country music's existence, because right when country music became a commercialized format available on records, I mean, the first major hits in the genre were songs that were basically just news stories put into song, like the record The Old 97, which became a big Johnny Cash song from Sun Records. That song was originally a big hit for Vernon Dalhart back in the early 20s, and that was considered the first big hit in country music, and it was based on a true story about the wreck of a train.
They give him his orders at Monroe, Virginia, saying, Pete, you're way behind time. This is not 38, but it's old 97. You must put her in center on time. He looked round, says to his black greasy fireman, just shove on in a little more coal. And when we cross that wide old mountain, you can watch old 97 roll.
And you'd have the death of Floyd Collins, or you'd have the sinking of the Titanic by Pop Stoneman. So there were all these songs that were about what was happening in the news, and they were ballads about, you know, what people had been reading about. And I'm sure a lot of country folk at that time who couldn't even afford a newspaper or couldn't read it if they wanted to, that was how they found out about stuff, was from those records and from performances by people who would travel around and sing songs of that kind.
And of course, we'd be remiss if we didn't mention that some of the many signature sounds of country music, you've got the fiddle, which came over across from Europe, and you have the banjo, which came from the African Americans. And this blending of cultures was already happening in the 1800s and the very pre-recording early 1900s.
Yeah, and if you've never seen it, and I mean you, Justin, or anyone listening, go check out Rhiannon Giddens. She's one of my favorite human beings alive right now. She's the one of the folks who founded the Carolina Chocolate Drops, the African-American string band. And she has a great solo career now and other projects. But something that she does that I love is that she plays an actual old-time minstrel banjo, which is the kind of banjos that were played in the 1800s that sound extremely different than what was played nowadays, or what you would expect to hear clawhammer or Earl Scruggs style. These banjos have a much deeper, more gutsy kind of sound to them that is remarkable to hear them play. It sounds like something thousands of years old when you listen to it. And if you look up her name, Rhiannon Giddens banjo, you can see her performing something like what you would have heard in the 1860s or 70s as performed by an African American at that time.
About some of the other music that comes through, because you have other influences. You have Cajun music, which is a blend of French Canadian and African American in New Orleans and in Louisiana. And similarly, you also have, as we were talking about earlier, you have gospel music, and you have what becomes blues music, also from the Black community.
Yeah, there's a huge cross section of musics that are just getting started, I'd say, around like the 1920s, and it's remarkable and a blessing that recording technology started when it did, and that we were able to capture a lot of these sounds as they started really happening in action. And I know that a lot of these recordings are real scratchy and distant and all that, but there is the American Epic documentary series that they did with Jack White and whatnot, and they have cleaned up a lot of these recordings in a way that makes them sound real vibrant. And I highly recommend anybody who is interested in where music comes from you got to hear these recordings from the 20s to the early 30s, because these recordings by Hawaiian groups, Germans playing polkas and waltzes, the Cajuns, the early gospel preachers and shouters, the minstrel music, the folk music. There's so much happening at that time, and all of it points towards things that were going to come later. But it's not just that. It's that that music is incredibly alive and vibrant even 100 years later.
Just because you think that you're pretty, just because you think that you're hot, just because you think you've got something that you think that I haven't got. You made me spend all my money. You thought I was old Santa Claus. I'm telling you, dude, I'm done with you.
There's one more branch that I want to talk about, but I'm going to hold that until after we get through the 1920s and talk about maybe the two most important acts that most country historians would point to. And in 1927, you have these recording sessions that have become iconic in the history of country music. There was a producer by the name, more of an A&R man, by the name of Ralph Peer, who was working for the Victor Talking Company, and he wanted to go out into the South and find previously unknown acts and record them and bring to light this potential new market, because there had already been success with a hillbilly act by the name of Fiddlin' John Carson, who was basically just doing, like we had talked about, a lot of traditional folk songs that had been brought over from Europe. And he was just an extremely talented fiddle player.
And I have this kind of fun local connection with Fiddlin' John Carson, because even though I live in Central Florida right now, I'm a Georgia boy. I'm from Atlanta, and Fiddlin' John was also from Atlanta. And there's still a lot of Fiddlin' John left there still, even 100 years later. He is buried there. His grave is there. There's even the street that his grave is on is named after him. And the building that he recorded his first recording in on Nassau Street actually stood until 2019 or 2020, I believe. And it was the building where the very first vocal country music record was ever made. It was when Ralph Peer came. It was his first trip down south to try to get some of the local acts. And John was told by somebody that Peer was coming, and he just kind of came in and did a couple of songs. And it ended up being the little old log cabin in the lane, which is the considered by country scholars to be the first vocal country record. There was a fiddle instrumental record that had come out shortly before that, but it was the first with singing on it.
Now I'm getting old and feeble, and I cannot work no more. That rusted-plated hoe I've laid to rest. Oh, Marcus and old Mister say I'm sleeping side by side. But there is now I roaming with the flares. Things have changed about the place now, and the darkest they have gone. You're up here, I'm singing in the cane. But the only friend that's left here is that good old dog of mine and the little old log cabin in the lane.
Unfortunately, Jimmy Buffett's Margaritaville Company had that building torn down, but I did get a chance to actually see it and take a picture with it and whatnot. And yeah, Fiddlin' John, he actually was a part of this really interesting community in Atlanta where they had these fiddlers contests that they would hold at the Georgia Municipal Auditorium, which is a very imposing, large building that is still there, and it's actually a part of my alma mater, Georgia State. And I'd pass by it every time on my way to classes and think about people like Gid Tanner and Fiddlin' John Carson and Clayton McMission, people like that playing there. And they would have these huge fiddlers conventions and contests, and Fiddlin' John won almost every one of them. He was a very dynamic, charismatic performer. And he set the stage for country music. And a lot of people call the Bristol sessions the Big Bang, but I think when John really inaugurated the commercial era of country music.
Yeah. Yo, I couldn't agree more. And so the Bristol sessions, as you referred to there, and there were certainly other artists that were recorded during these sessions, but the two that I think are hands down the most influential are the Carter family and Jimmie Rodgers. Tell us a little bit about the Carter family, Garrett.
So the Carter family are really it's not that, there's anybody who really invented country music or anything like that. As we said, it was something that was already in existence and there, then people started sort of recording it and it became commercialized. But really, if you're going to look at the actual invention of country music, the image, the way that it is thought of by people today, the way that the music has been passed down over time, the Carter family really represents one pole of country, and Jimmie Rodgers represents the other. And what the Carter family really represents is the sanctity of the home and family side, the one that honors God and mother and keeping the home together, and of this reverence and also a kind of acknowledgement of the hardships of mountain life, of farm life, and in general just living poor in the South.
There is a precious volume of finger worn and old in that little log cabin by the sea. It is the old Bible, more precious now than gold. It's the Bible that my mother gave to me. Is the old precious Bible, blessed Bible, that she read in the cabin by the sea. The precious, precious Bible, a blessed, blessed Bible, the Bible that my mother gave me.
And the Carter family are remarkable not just for the fact that they started so much of what they just kind of stumbled upon, but that, of course, their family line went down so far and long with people like Johnny Cash eventually being a part of it. That's the way most people are familiar with them, is through Johnny Cash. But they were absolutely enormous far before Johnny ever entered the picture. They were one of the very first groups to ever have the kind of sales that they had. And they recorded hundreds of sides in their time, which was just unheard of for most people. I mean, most people barely got a chance to do a couple of records, and they got to do hundreds of songs. And they were from the Clinch Mountain area in Virginia. And A.P. Carter, he would sell tree saplings. He went around and actually traveled around a lot and had this kind of restless spirit about him. And one day he heard this woman singing over the valley, and he thought that she had the most beautiful voice that he ever heard. So he went over to find out who it was, and it turned out that it was Sarah Doherty, I think was her name. And he, before long, they were married. He loved her voice, and he was a man who knew what he liked, and he went ahead and got her. And so they. Before too long, they had kids, and she was at home kind of watching the kids while he would go out and he would do his sales. And he loved music, and he would be kind of cataloging music in his brain as he went along and traveled around a lot. And he had this, interest in making music, but there wasn't really a commercial arena for him to do so in, right, until the Bristol sessions happened. And he hears about these people making a ton of money and says, well, you know, I got this great girl singer and I'm going to go over there. They had already been turned down by somebody that he had auditioned for because they said that girl singers didn't work and that nobody was going to buy a girl singer. And he thought that they were wrong, obviously. And he took not only his wife, but he also took Maybelle Carter with him. And so he had the two girls, and they went down to Bristol, and he had to patch the tire like three times just trying to get over there because the road was so rough. And you know, the girls didn't want to go because one of them was 8 months pregnant and the other was still nursing the new baby. But he got them there and they recorded, and the legend goes from there that, I mean, basically they just kept going in and recording, and every time they would make a recording, they would make basically what most people in their area made in a year's time in one recording session. So his interest in the music turned out wasn't such a crazy thing after all.
Oh, can the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a bitter home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
And just to clarify, Maybelle was actually Sarah's cousin originally.
Yes,
and
then Sarah's cousin, yes.
And then she ended up marrying AP's younger brother, Eck.
Yes.
And thus sort of officially making her a Carter as well.
Yep. And so they were indeed the Carter family. And they had, of course, the girls, Helen, June, and Anita later. But at this time, you have the Carter family, the three of them. And Maybelle played the guitar, and Sarah played the auto harp, and AP didn't play anything. He just kind of joined in occasionally. And Ralph actually asked him after a session, he said, you know, I noticed you didn't sing too much. And AP said, yeah, that's right. I just like to bass in every once in a while. So that was kind of his singing style. He would just bass in every now and then. But Maybelle, she really was the one who became a pioneer of her instrument, because she had this incredible technique where she would use her thumb to pick out the melody on the bass strings of the guitar, and she would use her fingers to provide the rhythm on the higher strings. And this became a style known as the Carter Scratch. And it was such a incredibly influential guitar style that it was said that virtually any country guitarist, the first thing that he did was learn Wildwood Flower, which was kind of the most iconic guitar part that she ever came up with. And there are stories of everybody from, you know, Dwayne Allman to Marty Stewart, whoever you want to name, anybody who ever played guitar, they probably tried to play the Carter Scratch at one point. It's still widely used in country music and bluegrass and everywhere else.
Oh, he taught me to love him and promised to love and to cherish me over all others above. How my heart feels there wandering, no misery can tell. He's left me no warning, no words of farewell.
And of course, if you have heard of the Carter family and some of their songs, aside from Wildwood Flower, I mean, Keep on the Sunny Side is another one of the big ones. Can the Circle Be Unbroken is another one of the big ones. Just a string of iconic, you know, early country hits. You know, Wabash Cannonball was another one. But as they went along, AP eventually ran out of all the songs in his head, so he started traveling around collecting new songs from folks to record. And he was accompanied by someone that he had befriended, a black man by the name of Leslie Riddle, or Esley Riddle, as he went by.
Yeah, and that was interesting because AP actually was not musically trained and couldn't really remember melodies. He could remember lyrics, so he would, you know, go around and mainly take the lyrics, whereas Leslie would remember the melodies, and then he would go back and tell the actual musicians in the group, Sarah and Maybelle, how to play their parts and what the melodies were. But for the longest time, AP didn't have anybody to go with, so when he would go on his song hunts, he'd come back with the lyrics with no melody, and the girls would just take some old melody that they knew and just put the new lyrics on it, which again is part of the process that we've been talking about of folk songs just, you know, radically changing. And the most famous example of a Carter family song being reworked in this way itself was Woody Guthrie taking When the World's on Fire and turning that into This Land Is Your Land, which almost everybody knows. And that was the exact same concept, which is I'm going to take a melody that I like from an older song, and I'm just going to put entirely new lyrics on it.
Oh, loving mother, when the world's on fire, don't you want God's bosom to be your pillow? I'd be over in the rocks of ages. Rocks of ages will farm me.
This land is your land, and this land is my land, from the California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me.
At the time, there wasn't so much that was... There wasn't as hard and fast rules about copyright at the time.
There was no blurred line cases at that time.
Right. and that led to one of the things that Ralph Peer absolutely did want to do is that he understood that the music publishing was a big business. You know, in urban environments, that was already starting to become a thing. And certainly you had Tin Pan Alley and you had minstrel music, and sheet music was really the record industry before there were recordings. You know, that was where you bought your music, was that you learned how to play those instruments, play it off the sheet music, and that was how they accounted for sales, you know, of music before the recording era. And so there was already huge money in sheet music and in owning copyrights. And so that was one of the big things that was encouraged at the time, was that you'll see as you go through a lot of the Carter family's music, oftentimes A.P. Carter is taking taking copyright credit for songs that he absolutely did not write. That now in hindsight we have obvious other recordings or other evidence that the songs existed before the Carters did them.
Yeah, and this is just a kind of a method of folk song collection done for commercial purposes that, of course, later you had people with a little bit more of a scholarly viewpoint when they were doing this, and I'm thinking mainly of John and Alan Lomax were doing a very similar thing, going around and just finding old songs. But in their case, they weren't really trying to use them for their own commercial benefit as much as just collect them for the Library of Congress. But in AP's case, I mean, the guy's got to have songs. They got to make their money. And so he goes around and he takes songs that haven't been copyrighted yet, things that he thinks they could record that somebody hasn't done yet. And he just takes advantage of a good opportunity, finds a good song. I mean, it was a thing that made sense at the time.
And then on the flip side, we have Jimmie Rodgers, and he represents a very different side of country music. He represents very much the rambler, the wanderer, the drifter.
Yeah, the pool hall, good timing, whiskey drinking, fun guy kind of image is definitely whoever you think of when you think of hell raising outlaw, good time guy, Hank Williams Jr. type thing. Jimmie Rodgers is the grandfather of all that. And that really was the kind of life that he lived before he was doing country music. It wasn't a big put on or anything like that. I mean, he mostly hung out in barbershops and pool halls, and he worked as a brakeman at the railroad, and he hung out with a lot of, you know, rough and tough kind of people. And that was the kind of other side of the tracks lifestyle that he lived. It wasn't the pious, you know, home mother and God kind of mentality of the Carter family. And he used that persona to his gain when he became a recording star.
I had a friend named Ramblin' Bob, who used to steal, gamble, and rob. He thought he was the smartest guy in town. But I found out last Monday that Bob got locked up Sunday. They've got him in the jailhouse way downtown. He's in the jailhouse now. He's in the jailhouse now.
Yeah, he sang about much more worldly things. I mean, one of his most famous recordings early on was famously In the Jailhouse Now, which was about a character by the name of Ramblin' Bob. It's an incredibly fun recording. even now, you know, what are we, we're coming up on 100 years later now, almost at this point.
His repertoire in general is about trains and being, you know, kind of around that environment. Of course, you know, women troubles, you know, them leaving him or him wanting to leave them, sometimes even killing them. You've got a lot of songs about these kind of interesting back alley seedy kind of characters, like you're talking about Ramblin' Bob, Frankie and Johnny, you know, all these almost Pulp Fiction characters. His whole world is populated with a little bit more of the dime novel sensation and interest than the Carter Family type stuff.
And one of the things that he brought into country music from very nearly the beginning is blues music and the influence of blues and jazz and black music.
If you don't want me, mama, you sure don't have to stop.
Lord, Lord.
If you don't want me, mama, you sure don't have to stop. 'Cause I can get more women than a passenger train can haul.
Yeah, Rodgers' musical taste and interests are definitely a bit more diverse than the Carter Family's. Big thing that they had going for them was this idea of their authenticity, their purity of vision, that they were really just a group with two people playing instruments and their voices, which of course it's beautiful, it's incredible. Jimmie Rodgers kind of represents the opposite side of the coin, which is let's just try any kind of music style, anything that I'm interested in that I happen to run across, and I'm going to put my own personal stamp on it, and I'm willing to try anything out. I mean, over the course of his career, he did perform a lot of times just him and a guitar, which he sounded wonderful. But there was also a lot of situations where he would pick up a band on the way to a recording session. He just liked the way that they sounded, and he would have them record with him. And so he ended up recording with all sorts of interesting combos, whether they were jazz ensembles or orchestras or African-American jug bands, Hawaiian groups, champion whistlers, all kinds of interesting folks that he would just either run across, or Ralph Peer would come up with something fun and different for him to try out. And of course, the greatest thing that he ever did in terms of trying something new was Ralph Peer set up a collaboration between him and the greatest artist in jazz music at that time, Louis Armstrong.
Standing on the corner, I didn't mean no harm. Along come a police, he took me by the arm. It was down in Memphis, corner of Beale and Main. He says, big boy, you'll have to tell me your name.
Yeah, Blue Yodel number 9, Standing on the Corner, which not only features Louis Armstrong, but also Louis' wonderful wife, Lil. And yeah, man, what a song. And this is like, it's pretty rock and roll, really, in attitude. The fact that you have these two individuals, these wonderful artists collaborating at a time when, you know, it was, you know, it would have been looked down upon, you know, the idea of a white and black artist working together. And yet here it is.
And artists of their stature too. I mean, it's hard to imagine, you know, it might have happened, and someone who's more of a jazz expert could tell me, but to me, this is like the 1920s equivalent of like Benny Goodman and Duke Ellington being on the same recording. It's just kind of unfathomable to me that, you know, artists of this stature got together and did a collaboration. But it just kind of shows how there's a little bit more of a freewheeling sensibility in the recordings of the 20s. And I think that it was a total lightning in a bottle moment where, I mean, they had what really who I consider to be the two greatest American music figures of this time as representing two different strains of music. And of course, you know, obviously I'm discounting some of the blues artists and stuff like that, but I'm really talking about just popular American music. These are really the two giants, and to have them both be on the same recording at their absolute best. I mean, Armstrong, it's one of his best performances I've ever heard. And same for Rodgers. I mean, Rodgers sounds like he has more swagger than two Mick Jaggers on this song. It's just amazing.
Yeah. And of course it's about a club in Memphis at the corner of Beale and Main.
Yep. Which is a spot that I went to on my trip to Graceland. I told my wife, I have to go stand at the corner of Beale and Main, just like Jimmie Rodgers.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Now, a moment ago, you slid right over it, but you said a very key little phrase there when you were talking about some of the folks that Jimmie Rodgers collaborated with as well. But you mentioned Hawaiian music, and that brings in the other sort of angle on the sound of country music and sort of the stereotypical sounds of country, because there was the introduction of the steel guitar into country music, and that actually would maybe surprise folks how deep that goes back and how weird and sort of roundabout it got to country music, because there's actually a lot of Spanish influence on country music that I don't think a lot of people pick up on unless they literally think of much later on, you know, the more explicit stuff, you know, Tex-Mex music and stuff like that. But in all actuality, the steel guitar was effectively brought by Spaniards to Hawaii when they were colonizers. And then the Hawaiians, the indigenous Hawaiians, reworked it into their own sort of instrument and their own way of signature way of playing. And in fact, one of the first fads in popular recorded music was a Hawaiian craze that started in live theater in the 19 teens and then carried over into recorded music in the 1920s. And then that was picked up by white entertainers and brought back to the mainland. And you end up having particularly one individual and a band that may have single-handedly helped popularize the steel guitar. And that's Lonnie McIntyre and his Aloha Islanders. And they worked with Jimmie Rodgers on a handful of recordings, one of which that I found incredibly fascinating that I want to talk about is Everybody Does It in Hawaii, which was, crazily enough, the flip side of Frankie and Johnny.
Talk about Hawaii, I didn't know it was so grand. I picked me out a hula hula girl before my boat could land. Everybody does it in Hawaii. The hula baby.
Yep, and of course, later an Elvis movie song right there. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Everybody Does It in Hawaii. What is the thing that everybody does in Hawaii? That is the mystery to this day. So the disc review of this song at the time that I sent to Justin, and we had our really weird, you know, little brain match moment. It was a review at the time that misspelled Jimmie Rodgers' name, first of all, as a lot of people did and have done. But it says, More Frankie and Johnny, and backed by everybody, does it in Hawaii. Dealers should use discrimination and not sell this into polite families or for juvenile consumption. It's never made clear what everybody does in Hawaii. That leaves the sensitive listeners in a state of unrelieved embarrassment.
Yeah. Love it. Now, the other side of the Spanish influence, just to before we dig a little bit more on the Hawaiian stuff and the steel guitar, you've also got the iconography of the cowboy. And that goes back to Spanish agriculture and cattle ranching and the fact that, you know, you had that in Mexico and then it sort of migrated upwards into the American South. And so Western wear in the early to mid 20th century was very much inspired by the costumes of vaqueros, you know, cowboys. And that was in turn inspired by the costumes of Spanish royalty, which had been used in such activities as bullfighting. And I know we're borrowing from Tyler Mahan Coe here, but those in and of themselves paved the way for Nudie Cohn's famous rhinestone studded suits, which in turn paved the way for not only Elvis's cowboy costume in Loving You, but the jumpsuits.
Right. And of course, talking about the invention of the kind of the myth of the American cowboy and of the singing cowboy and all that, it really dawned on me for the first time while we were researching this, just how much of Elvis's career that there has been like these cowboy, singing cowboy type movie things that have gone on that really kept revolving around his life in different ways. Like you said, like the Loving You shirt, the Love Me Tender, the Charo, Flaming Star. I mean, there is so many things that, you know, literally would not have happened in Elvis's life if it had not been for, you know, Jimmie Rodgers all the way back in the 20s, putting on some cowboy clothes and calling himself the yodeling cowboy, that, you know, that this is the path that leads us down to other artists we're going to talk about later. But literally Jimmie Rodgers doing that created the idea of the singing cowboy, that leads to singing cowboy movies and then Elvis's career. So like you said, it's amazing how many connections happen when you start to really think about this stuff. But there is a book that I read. I highly recommend anybody who finds interesting what we're talking about here with Jimmie Rodgers should read. I actually, after I read it, I called it my favorite book on American roots music that I had read, at least about a single subject, which was a book by Barry Mazur called Meeting Jimmie Rodgers. And it's not a biography per se. It's actually a book about his influence and a book about how he impacted the musical world, not just in his time, but throughout time. And I think that Barry makes a really strong case that Jimmie Rodgers may be the single most influential artist in all of music. You know, even talking about Elvis and Bing Crosby and Frank Sinatra and Stevie Wonder, anybody that you want to name, that, I mean, Jimmy at least should be right up in there in that conversation in terms of the most influential 20th century artists that there were, because he started so many strains of American music and started so many trends that it's staggering. I mean, I could sit here and talk about all the different ways that he impacted literally every genre of music.
Frankie and Johnny were sweethearts. Oh, Lord, how they did love. Swore to be true to each other. True as the stars above, he was her man. He wouldn't do her wrong. Frankie went down to the corner just for a bucket of beer. She says, Mr. Bartender, has my lovin' Johnny been here? He's my man. He wouldn't do me wrong.
He died very early. We didn't talk about the fact that he traveled around a lot and was a drifter and a rambler, as we said. And eventually it turned out that he had been diagnosed with tuberculosis, which at the time they had no cure for. And so it was basically just a death sentence for him. And everybody knew who was a fan of his that he was dying, he put out songs like TB Blues, where he was talking about facing the grave. And he had this remarkable sense of basically just saying, you know, I know I'm going to die, but I'm going to squeeze every inch of life I can out before I go. And he performed tons of shows. He loved playing for his fans. And he literally was recording right up until the last minute. He was in the hotel trying to make some records, and that was where he passed. And so he lived this incredibly full life and had a even longer legacy behind him that kicked off the 1930s. I even view the 1930s in country music as almost a response to what Rodgers had already laid down.
Yeah, that's a great way of putting it. So as we roll into the 1930s, there's a thing that happens towards the end of the 20s. Obviously, radio starts to become hugely popular, but country music actually starts to get a serious radio presence. And of course, the most famous of which was the WSM Barn Dance, which soon came to be called, as a jokey contrast with the lead-in program featuring actual grand opera classical music, the Grand Ole Opry.
From Nashville, Tennessee, Prince Albert, the world's most popular smoking tobacco, brings you the South's most popular program, the Grand Ole Opry.
Got my sunny shoes on, got my hair slicked down,
having a big time tonight.
Can of good Prince Albert, boys are pleasure bound,
having a big time tonight. Going to the hoedown in my Sunday clothes, having a big time tonight. Going to still be dancing when the rooster crows, having a big time tonight.
Longest running show in American history.
And, oh man, where do we even start with the Grand Ole Opry?
Yeah, I mean, well, and prior to the Grand Ole Opry, you had, we give a little shout out to my Chicago people here. I mean, in Chicago, you had WLS, National Barn Dance, which was the biggest country music show at that time. And George D. Hay, the solemn old judge, the man who started the Grand Ole Opry, that's what he was trying to emulate when he started the Grand Ole Opry. And, you know, he was really a great salesman of the music is how I view him, because he had this whole idea that if you presented people, even urban people, as being these kind of backwoods hillbillies, that a lot of the rural people would really eat up that act and view them as one of them, and that they would really enjoy it even more. And so what he was doing was taking in all these people around Nashville who were really urban sophisticates, people like Dr. Humphrey Bates and his possum hunters. They were originally called Dr. Humphrey Bates and his like something orchestra, you know, like, I mean, it wasn't possum hunters or and then there was a group that George D. Hay called the Fruit Jar Drinkers, all kinds of just, you know, funny names like Skillet Liquors was a name from Georgia, but, you know, it was names like that that he was trying to come up with. And
now, so, hold on. Are you trying to say that country music was pandering?
They figured out the words and the phrases they can use to pander to their audience, and they list the same words and phrases off sort of Mad Lib style in every song, raking in millions of dollars from actual working class people. You know the words, you know the phrases, phrases like a dirt road, a cold beer, a blue jeans, a red pickup, a rural noun, simple adjective.
Well, there's a whole aspect of country music that is called the fabricated authenticity. So, and that is exactly what the Grand Ole Opry was built on, was the idea of fabricated authenticity, that we're going to take these guys that you know, we're probably reading Shelley and Keats by day and performing as moonshiners at night. And you just have this really interesting environment where you can have someone like Uncle Jimmy Thompson or Uncle Dave Macon, who are these real old school vaudevillian minstrel type performers, or even Civil War veteran in Jimmy Thompson's case. And you have these guys that are the real deal that are playing these old fiddle songs or the old banjo songs, the minstrel entertainments and whatnot. And then you got these people that are playing the square dance music. It was really meant as a time where you could turn on the radio and you could kind of have your own at-home square dance or even perform it. So you could turn on the radio somewhere and have a lot of people dance to it. So they were really trying to create a situation where people who are the hardworking, poor Southern folk could listen in on Saturday night and have something that reminded them of the good old times of home and give them something to dance to.
Just know that they were and remain like the gatekeepers of country music, I guess you could say, would maybe be the best way to describe it.
I'd kind of say they were like the conduit by which most people experienced country music.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really the way that if you ask anybody who became a country artist later or were country fans at that time, most people would say something to the effect of, oh, yeah, I'd listen to the Grand Ole Opry, or, you know, I knew those artists because I listened to the Grand Ole Opry. Even a lot of blues black artists say the same thing. I mean, like Muddy Waters and Robert Johnson, people like that, they were listening to the Grand Ole Opry, too.
And it's worth mentioning that in those earliest days, you certainly had a few black artists like DeFord Bailey who would play on the Opry as well.
Yeah, it was a much more open, like, well, you know, they did become big gatekeepers, but back in the early, more wild and free days in the 30s, George D. Hay would let a lot of interesting people perform on there, and DeFord Bailey was one of them, and he was actually somebody that, you know, one of the other artists had found and brought him in, and he turned out to be this incredible harmonica player. And one of my favorite stories about the Opry was that someone had written in and said, we love DeFord Bailey, but will you please warn us the next time that he's going to play that song Fox Chase, because he performed it and we didn't know what to expect. And at the end of the song, when he started saying, sick him, get him, our dog actually got up and tore the entire furnishings apart.
Hey, get it. Get it.
That's spectacular. Oh, I love that story.
Yeah.
And I love that recording that we have of it, you know, of him doing the song.
Yes.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, he didn't make many recordings, and if you want to kind of know what happened to DeFord Bailey, there's a book by Paul Hemphill called The Nashville Sound. And he actually, I think, met DeFord Bailey at a barbershop that he worked at in the 60s. And this was the time that Hemphill was writing the book. And, of course, DeFord had some bitterness about his time on the Opry, considering that he had been unceremoniously booted out of the Opry after it had been claimed that he wouldn't learn any new songs, quote unquote. But of course, you know, the real reason that he, you know, said, and of course, you know, what I believe him was that it was more racial problems and just that it just wasn't as free as it was in the '20s. And, yeah, so it just was one of those sad stories about someone who had glory back then, but had been kind of squeezed out of the industry, you know, undeservedly so. But I'm glad to say that his legacy is still very much alive. His recordings can still be heard. When I was working at a record store in Atlanta, I actually met one of his great-granddaughters. She came into the store.
Wow.
She came into the store and said, my great-grandfather actually was a big country music star in the early days. And I said, you know, oh, what was his name? She said, DeFord Bailey. And I said, oh, yeah, Fox Chase. And, you know, started naming the songs. And she just looked stunned that I knew who he was. Absolutely shocked that I knew him.
So parallel to that, there's also the rise of jug bands and hokum music. And a while back, quite a while back by the time this episode comes out on the main feed, I did a little diving into the history of jug bands. When I was covering the Elvis song Barefoot Ballad.
But, a worthy endeavor to start with that.
But in all seriousness, jug bands were genuinely extremely popular back in the day. And it was a blend of jazz and Cajun and blues, the Delta blues. and a little bit of country in there as well. And it's interesting how country has sort of evolved from what was, broadly speaking, an African-American art form into something that is pretty much only associated with country music nowadays.
Yeah, and there's a lot of great jug bands, especially in the Memphis area. There was the Memphis jug band that was the prominent one at the time that I haven't done the research on it recently, so you can, you know, add mm-hmm. anything you want here. But I mean, that band in particular, I mean, they're the ones that I think of the most when I think of jug bands. I mean, they did great songs like On the Road Again. They actually did their own version of In the Jailhouse Now.
You remember Henry Cruz, that soul had no good blues. He sold it to the police on the beat. Now Henry's feeling funny, police give him mock money. He's got a ball and chain around his feet. He's in the jailhouse now. He's in the jailhouse now. The judge gave him 2 years, and Henry's shedding tears.
They were a hugely influential and popular group in the blues fold at that time. But of course, it ended up being something that spread far and wide and into country music. And of course, that's a big part of the early Memphis blues days, which is something that obviously has evolved to a certain point by the time that Elvis enters the picture.
Right. And then I just briefly mentioned there as well hokum music, which was sort of parallel with country music at the time, was very much more it was sort of nested between jug bands and you know, country music at the time. And what it was that it was a lot more rowdy. It was more comedic, oftentimes, depending on where you got it, very lewd. And you guys actually, you and Nate actually talked a little bit about some hokum music on Holy Roll, talking about Tampa Red and Georgia Tom.
Yeah, and this is one of the interesting ways that music just crossed over constantly at the time into ways that we wouldn't necessarily think of it. But Thomas A. Dorsey was really the inventor of what we think of as gospel music. And if you want to know more about him, I'm not going to go fully into it, but we did a whole episode about him on that show. And he actually composed songs that Elvis recorded later, like Peace in the Valley. And, you know, he was basically the man who started the idea of the gospel music publishing industry, of the performance style. And he became this just hugely influential figure, to the point that even when gospel music was kind of an inchoate format, people referred to gospel songs as Dorsey's. And he had such an incredible pull on the Black American church at that time, but he also didn't make a whole lot of money doing what he did. And so there were certain temptations to try to find a way to make money elsewhere. And at the height of his success in gospel music, this wasn't prior to his career in gospel music or anything like that. This was while he was currently successful in gospel. He had this kind of alternate life as a performer named Georgia Tom, and he would do these hokum songs with Tampa Red, and they were these very lewd body songs. And Thomas Dorsey did compose them. He wrote those songs.
I'm going to include a clip. You guys got to hear Tight Like That. Like, it's so amazing.
Folks, that's Tight Like That. Yeah, thank you, Tampa Red. God bless, boy. Uncle Bud, Mary Jane, went to take a pen, her Mary Jane, still dying. Uncle Bud died, he lived tight back then. He loved on boy, tight back then. He loved on boy, you have a daughter, too. I need a tight back then. If you see my gal, tell her to hurry home. I ain't had no friends, but she been going to tight back then. She loved on boy, tight back then.
Yeah, it's Tight Like That. That's a that's a magical recording. And I think that if you want to hear just Prince before Prince happened. You know, definitely check out Thomas Dorsey. I mean, a man that could go from a song like that to a song like Peace in the Valley, you know, very, very, very quickly. And he didn't speak against those songs later either. I mean, when he was interviewed later and people would ask him about the Hokum songs, he would say, well, you know, I think that basically part of God's vision for mankind is, you know, making love, and that that's a part of life. And I see nothing wrong with blues songs. I love the blues songs that I wrote. So he really, unlike a lot of people who were, you know, very against blues music, like there were some major gospel artists at the time who completely rejected blues music, like Lucy Campbell, who was a great, great composer, but she despised blues music and saw it as this evil thing, whereas Thomas Dorsey was not only totally cool with it, but was a major figure of the genre. So I think it's interesting that, you know, you really have a precursor again to what Elvis kind of accomplished in his time of being someone who was capable of doing the rock and roll material, but was also capable of doing this sacred type of music. And of course, it just makes sense that one of the songs that he would have done right in the midst of him performing rock and roll was a Thomas Dorsey song like Peace in the Valley or Precious Lord, Take My Hand, because that had already been pioneered by the man himself.
Another artist, well, a couple artists worth talking about in the mid-1930s is Bob Wills and Slade Cooley and the subgenre of Western swing music.
Yeah, Western swing is really the Texan version of country and jazz swing coming out at that time. In the 30s, you had, and this is a whole separate thing, you had the creation of big band music and of swing music. And basically, these are country artists that are taking swing music and are shaping it to their own influences, that especially in Texas, you have such a cross section. Like you're talking about, there's the Spanish music, you have the German polka music, that that beat is very much a polka beat. You have the obviously country music, you have the Jimmie Rodgers type stuff. Tommy Duncan sang a lot of Jimmie Rodgers with Bob Wills. And you just have this whole jazz element. So it's like if you just take all the various Texas type genres of Spanish music, the Germanic music, the country music, and then you threw it into a pot with the jazz swing, you're going to get Western swing music. And it's a incredible genre, because it's one of those things where I saw somebody posted a Western swing album on a Facebook group I'm on, and they said, you know, not that there are any bad Western swing albums, but this one is particularly good. And that's just the way that I feel about this music. I mean, a lot of people have problems with Spade Cooley because, I mean, he was objectively in a reprehensible evil murderer. And, you know, obviously your level of being able to separate the art from the artist will be there when it comes to that guy. And if you want to know more about that side of him, Tyler Mahan Co. did far more than any human being ever should have had to go through on his podcast, Cocaine and Rhinestones. But Spade Cooley was a superstar in his day. Bob Wills, too, and the Light Crust Doughboys, Milton Brown and his musical Brownies. You have so many great groups going at that time, and it's all good music. I'm telling you, like, if you like, you know, proto rock and roll, early rockabilly, swing music. I mean, I can't imagine, unless you're just one of these, like, I hate all old music type people, can't imagine somebody not liking Western swing.
I mean, the thing about Western swing is that it is the antithesis of the whole idea of, you know, that I'm crying in my beer at the bar, you know, and that country is just whiny. It is so full of life and so wonderful. And even the songs that are about, you know, like crying in your beer, are really fun. know?
Yeah, Cindy Walker wrote this great song for Bob Wills called Bubbles in My Beer.
I love Bubbles in My Beer.
And it is a great, great song. It is not whiny at all. And my favorite thing about that song is that Cindy Walker was a very dainty lady, and she never had a drink of beer in her life. And that's one of the best beer songs ever written. So, hey, you don't have to have direct experience to write great art about it.
A vision of someone who loves me brings a long, silent tear to my eyes. Oh, I know that my life's been a failure, just watching the bubbles in my beer.
Yeah.
And Bob Wills similarly pulling a little bit from the blues and what would start to become rhythm and blues as well. You know, one of the songs that would be a crossover is Corrine Corrina, and kind of swap between blues and jazz and country and Western swing. And it was always in dialogue, you know, and there, he's got a great version of that.
Corrine Corrina, where you been so long? Tell me, Corrina, where you been so long? Ain't had no loving since you've been gone.
Oh, Corrina. Yes, Leon, swing out, boy, swing out.
The iconic Ida Red, which we'll get back to in a little bit.
But Bob Wills did something that, to me, is kind of the thing that gets rock and roll going from where he was, which was that he, and this is according to Andrew Hickey in his music podcast, The History of Rock and Roll in 500 Songs. So if you got a problem with this statement, go to him. but Andrew Hickey claims, and I think gives really good evidence for that, Bob Wills is the man who introduced the backbeat into popular music.
Yeah.
And I mean, there is no rock and roll without the backbeat. That is just absolutely foundational. To me, the difference between something truly being like a rock and roll record or a proto rock record is the difference between does it have a backbeat or not. And that is something that Bob Wills introduced, and or at least was one of the earliest pioneers of. And Bob Wills, when he was interviewed in the 50s, he was actually interviewed 1956, I believe, and someone said, what do you think of this new rock and roll music? And he said, new? I've been playing that since 1944.
It's true.
Yeah, I've been playing that for 20 years.
I don't disagree with him.
Yep. So I don't disagree with him either. And truly, I mean, I could slip Bob Wills into any early rock playlist, and I seriously doubt that people would be able to tell the difference, you know, if they're at a party or something like that. Like, it is so similar, and it doesn't surprise me at all that Bill Haley became an early rock guy because he came from Western swing, too. But, yeah, Western swing is absolutely one of the precursors to rock and roll, but is, again, I hate saying things like that because it makes it sound like, oh, well, this is just another step we had to use to get to a good thing. Rock and roll is my favorite musical genre, but it doesn't mean I think any of these are lesser or you know, really they're only good as so far as they are building blocks of rock and roll. It is truly great in and of itself, and I love listening to Western swing exactly for what it is. And I also want to make sure that we mention in the 1930s, two of the biggest things going on at that time besides Bob Wills was the Singing Cowboys, like we talked about. You had Gene Autry, you had Roy Rogers, Sons of the Pioneers, and this was the beginning of what I would call soft country. This was the beginning of basically having orchestras and strings kind of backing you up. And this is something Tyler in his podcast talks about too, that really the beginning of what we call country pop or the Nashville sound is actually singing cowboy music.
Have I told you lately that I love you? Could I tell you once again somehow? Have I said with all my heart and soul how I adore you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now.
And so that's something that's going to factor in real huge into Elvis's career. Not only the Nashville sound, the pop country sound, but also the imagery and material of singing cowboys. And then you also have Roy Acuff, who completely changed the Grand Ole Opry in one fell swoop, because prior to Roy Acuff, you had these groups like we were talking about, like Dr. Humphrey Bates and his Possum Hunters, or you would have the Fruit Jar Drinkers, these kind of old-time music groups. And Roy Acuff is the first singular superstar of the Grand Ole Opry that is a solo singer that and a lot of times the singers in country music were not trying to sing in any kind of a soulful or impassioned kind of way. They were mostly singing almost like square dance calls. Like if you listen to any record by like the Skillet Lickers or Uncle Dave Macon, it has this very, I'm going to go, hey, you know, very call, like they're calling stuff out and doing the little dance raps and all that kind of stuff. But then you get to Roy Acuff, and it sounds like he's literally about to break down in tears on the stage as he's singing about, you know, a wreck on the highway, or about the great speckled bird, or about the Wabash Cannonball, the night train to Memphis. I mean, he's got this incredibly impassioned voice that has that kind of teardrop in the voice that a lot of people talk about with people like him or Tammy Wynette or whatever, that he's the beginning of that.
What a concerning a great speckled bird. Remember her name is recorded on the pages of God's holy word.
And this becomes the establishment of singers in country music and music in general who have a lot more feeling to them versus technique.
Yeah.
So someone like Hank Williams, you know, said that Roy Acuff was pretty much his primary vocal influence next to Ernest Tubb. And so there, you really can't talk about the way that the Grand Ole Opry or country music evolved without talking about the fact that Roy Acuff became the first superstar in the wake of Jimmie Rodgers passing to kind of take on the new mantle of being country music's big star. And he didn't do it by being a cowboy or any of the stuff that Jimmie Rodgers had pioneered. He stuck to this whole Appalachian Mountain image and never put on a cowboy hat, never did what anybody else was doing at the time, that he just stuck right to that Smoky Mountain Boys image. Mm-hmm.
Just a very emotionally expressive singer. You know?
Yes.
And that led to great financial success, which he was then able to funnel into something at the start of the 1940s. Him and Fred Rose, songwriter Fred Rose, got together and founded a publishing company, Acuff Rose, to capitalize on the rising popularity of hillbilly music around this time, or country music at the time. And as you mentioned, you start to see in Hollywood the nostalgia and the, I'm trying to think of the right word for this, the appeal, I guess, the widespread commercial appeal of cowboys. And you mentioned Gene Autry and Roy Rogers and Sons of the Pioneers, and you've got all these great, very technically well-sung songs. You know, you think about, you know, songs like Back in the Saddle Again, or, you know, South of the Border, stuff like that from Gene Autry, and they're very cleanly performed recordings.
I'm back in the saddle again, out where a friend is a friend, where the longhorn cattle feed on the lowly gypsum weed. Back in the saddle again,
riding the range once more.
But along with them, the biggest pop star on the planet starts to adapt some country music as well. Bing Crosby.
Oh, give me land, lots of land, under starry skies above. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the wide open country that I love. Don't fence me in. Let me be by myself in the evening breeze and listen to the murmur of the cottonwood trees.
Yeah, Bing being the man who basically invented solo singing as we know it. And now he tackles so many genres. I mean, of course, back in the early days, he kind of stuck to that pop crooner type repertoire. But as time went on, he had this whole streak where he was doing all kinds of different genres, trying out lots of different styles. It was like sort of a precursor to someone like Connie Francis or someone like that, where it's like, let's just make this person sing anything and see how it sounds.
Yeah.
And one of the ones that he tried and that really worked for him was country music and cowboy music.
Yeah. One of my absolute favorite Bing Crosby like cowboy songs is "I'm an Old Cowhand" from the Rio Grande from the movie Rhythm on the Range. Like, that is such an earworm. I love that song.
Yippee-i-yo,
cow. I'm an old cowhand and I come down from the Rio Grande. And I learned to ride, ride, ride before I learned to stand. I'm a riding fool who is up to date. I know every trail in the Lone Star State, cause I ride the range in the Ford V8. Oh, yippee-i-yo, kaye. Da-da-da-da-dee-da-da-da.
And if I may be misremembering, but if I remember correctly, that song was written by Johnny Mercer, who he just had this great sensibility for wordplay and a wonderful sense of melody. And yeah, that song definitely is a standout in his catalog. And he's also from Georgia, so I got to shout out my Georgia boy right there. But yeah, I'm an old cowhand. I love there's a whole kind of joke about that song, basically, because I mean the entire time he's singing about how, you know, he's an old cowhand from the Rio Grande, but you know, he drives a truck and he does all, basically,
very tongue-in-cheek.
He does all these things that are not real things that cowboys do, and yet he's claiming that he does. And honestly, that song could sum up the entire fabricated authenticity of country music at this time, that, you know, they're coming in and saying, oh yeah, we work out in the fields, or we rustle cattle, or all this stuff, when really they're coming to work in limousines.
I walk and talk like a field hand, but the boots I'm wearing cost $3,000. I write songs about riding tractors from the comfort of a private jet. I could sing in Mandarin, could still know I'm pandering. Hunting deer, chasing trout, a Bud Light with the logo facing out.
But along those same lines, another great Bing Crosby country song, and Roy Rogers also touched on this song, but "Don't Fence Me In" was a huge hit for Bing Crosby and the Andrews Sisters.
Right.
It sold over, I think, a million copies. Like, massive, massive hit.
And again, written by a total sophisticate,
Cole Porter. Yeah.
Right. I mean, basically the epitome of musical sophistication, or whatever you would call that, in the Tin Pan Alley years. I mean, we're talking about the guys who, you know, wrote songs like "Night and Day" and, you know, "I Get a Kick Out of You" and stuff like that. I mean, Cole Porter, Johnny Mercer, Frank Lesser, these were all these guys, you know, the Gershwins, Lawrence Hart, Richard Rodgers, you know, all these Tin Pan Alley writers. They're writing now cowboy songs for the movies and stuff. So you end up getting these songs where, like, Cole Porter writes a great country song, which, like, who would have thought?
Yeah. And one thing that you said to me, you know, in sort of our pre-show discussions, is that there's an argument to be made that Bing Crosby did more for the popularization of country music than just about anybody at his point in the 20th century. And that certainly is reflected in the sales and putting those songs out. Now, certainly you can go, well, he never was on the Grand Ole Opry and he never did this and he never did that. You know, he's not a country singer. He's Bing Crosby. He's the pop singer. He's the crooner. And this gets down to the crux of where I think we're going to start leading to is who gets to define what country music is, you know, and who's to put those borders up and to put those lines in the sand.
And of course, country music, as we've seen from the beginning, was driven by money. And, you know, of course, there was obviously for the artists different motives of wanting to promote, you know, morally good values or of, you know, wanting to tell stories or worship God or whatever it may be. But the business of country music is a business. It's about making money. And someone like Bing Crosby comes along, and of course, he's an established superstar, pretty much the great star of his entire time. And here's a guy who not only basically endorses country music, but becomes a country music artist. And there's just no telling what kind of an impact that had on people at the time that they would never, ever listen to someone like Ernest Tubb or Roy Acuff, but they love Bing Crosby. So they'll go out and buy Don't Fence Me In and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And they're buying country music. So, I mean, this is the same thing that has happened so many times over the years where somebody like the Byrds in the 60s, they record country and now hippies who would never listen to it are listening to it. Or, you know, oh, this person would never, you know, like country in the 80s, but, you know, now, you know, so-and-so is recording a country song. So, yeah, it's the same idea over and over again played out, but Bing Crosby's really the first star of his like that actually did something like that, and you can point to, like, you know, other singers of his type, like Tony Bennett doing Hank Williams later and whatnot as being in the same vein, but I mean, Bing really did stick with this for a while. Like, there were several releases over decades of him, of albums of him doing country songs. And, yeah. You know, and it wasn't just that he created awareness of country music among people who would otherwise never care to listen to it. He directly influenced country music singers. It is just undeniable to me that Lefty Frizzell is influenced by Bing Crosby. Like, there's no way that you jump from Hank Williams nasal, you know, type singing to Lefty Frizzell without Bing Crosby being in the mix in there somewhere. And Merle Haggard himself admitted that Bing Crosby was one of his, like, top three or so vocalists of all time that he tried to emulate, and you can totally hear it. So if you think that Bing Crosby ain't country, then Merle Haggard would like to have a word with you.
Yeah. And here's where we can bring it back around. You had Lonnie McIntyre working with Jimmie Rodgers, as we talked about, but you also have that Bing Crosby connection there, because Bing Crosby stars in Waikiki Wedding, and literally the steel guitarist and band that are accompanying him in there is Lonnie McIntyre and his Aloha Highlanders doing songs that are iconic now, partly for the connections to Elvis Presley, like Blue Hawaii.
Night and you and blue Hawaii, the night is heavenly and you are heaven to me.
Yeah, this is all like, and again, I'm sure people are starting to kind of just start to feel the weight of just how many connections and things happen here. But I mean, Elvis's whole career and everything is a response to all these things that are happening at the beginning of his career. At least none of what happened to him just came out of midair. All this stuff had been set down for, in several cases, decades prior. Like you said, I mean, Blue Hawaii, I had no idea that that was not a Elvis song to begin with. And then when I heard Bing Crosby's version, I was blown away.
So as we roll through the 40s, there's a handful of artists that are absolutely worth digging into. And we start to near the people who are actually directly involved with Elvis Presley's career a little bit later, either as immediate direct influences or people who actually, like, legit played a factor in his career. Now, of course, we've got to mention Hank Snow. And he was similarly very much influenced from the side of country music that was in the lineage of Jimmie Rodgers.
Yeah, not just, you know, that he was interested in Jimmie Rodgers or, you know, was a fan. But, I mean, this man virtually worshipped Jimmie Rodgers.
He literally named his son Jimmie Rodgers.
Yeah, his son's name is not just Jimmy, it's Jimmie Rodgers Snow. It's just unbelievable. If I asked my wife to name my son Jimmie Rodgers Cash, I would have been slapped. But somehow this man got away with that. But yeah, he did multiple Jimmie Rodgers tribute albums. I've got almost all of them, I think. But no, I mean, he is absolutely one of these guys like Gene Autry, like Ernest Tubb, who literally started their career as Jimmie Rodgers impersonators. This was the way his career got started. And he was called the Yodeling Ranger in Canada. And of course, you know, Jimmie Rodgers was the Yodeling Cowboy toward the end of his career. So Hank Snow picked up that mantle and just tried to run with it in Canada. And then he came down to America to work in Nashville and whatnot, and dropped the Yodeling Ranger thing and went for, you know, a new kind of style, the Singing Ranger. And he just came up with this really interesting mix of styles. Like in the early 50s was when he started hitting his stride. He had these very cool proto-rockabilly songs that had this great drive to them, like I'm Moving On and The Golden Rocket and Music Making Mama from Memphis. So these songs that had this great driving acoustic guitar rhythm to them that clearly set the stage for the Sun Records guys like Johnny Cash and Elvis.
That big eight wheeler rolling down the track means your two loving daddy ain't coming back, cause I'm moving on, I'll soon be gone. You are flying too high for my little old sky, so I'm moving on. I was a good engine running on time, but baby, I'm switching to another line. So honey, never hang your signal out for me. I'm tired of running on the same old track, bought a one-way ticket and I won't be back. This golden rocket's gonna roll my blues away. She'll play a little rhythm, do the boogie upright, a Tennessee polka, maybe blues in the night. Everybody travels from near and far to hear her when she picks it on that old guitar. My music-making mama from Memphis, Tennessee.
He also did a lot of the old-school Victorian, you know, mother and home type songs like the Carter family did. But he also loved experimenting with like Latin music, Latin rhythms and things like that. So there's songs like the Rumba Boogie. He was like the first guy to want to try something like a cha-cha record or whatever. And I think that he was one of the most interesting country artists of his time just for his willingness to try anything out, which of course seems like a Jimmie Rodgers influence there again. But he played blues music, all kinds of material, and he became one of the primary reasons that Elvis got a career later on, of course. And he's depicted in the Elvis movie in a way that I wrote about in a magazine that I was not a big fan of the way he was depicted in that.
Yeah.
But yeah, he does talk about Elvis in his autobiography. It was a whole situation, and not to get too much into it, but basically Hank Snow did play a part in discovering Elvis, but in a business sense, he got squeezed out of the deal by Tom Parker, and that was a sad thing. But Hank always loved Elvis, and he talked about later in his book about how he would still visit with Elvis and talk with him, and that he had pictures of him and Elvis up on the wall in his office, and they're still there at the Rainbow Ranch to this day.
So let's go ahead and quickly handle a few more important, significant influences that were around in the 1940s, because there's Ernest Tubb, who we know was a big influence on Elvis Presley, and we also have Bill Monroe, who would famously write the B-side to Elvis's first commercial single, and guys like Red Foley and Merle Travis.
Yeah, so to start with Ernest, I mean, again, a Jimmie Rodgers tribute artist. He had a tonsillectomy that changed his voice and made it impossible for him to yodel like Rodgers, so he had to change his whole style. But the reason why he changed his style was that he was making music that sounded like Jimmie Rodgers' music, which is a little more acoustic. But the music that the places that the music was getting played back at that point in the late 30s, early 40s was jukeboxes and honky-tonks. And when you're in a bar where a bunch of people are talking and it's really loud and you got the glasses clinking and there's the party atmosphere going on, they don't want to hear something that sounds like the Carter Family or some acoustic guy in a guitar. And you can't even hear it. It doesn't even cut through the noise. So Ernest came up with this arrangement where he was going to do a song where there was going to be an electric guitar piercing through it where people could actually hear it through all the noise. And that became the song Walking the Floor Over You, which is kind of the signature song for Ernest Tubb. And if you go listen to the original 1941 recording, it's got that real sharp piercing guitar line on it that you could hear anywhere.
And that, of course, is partly where you get some of the influence on Scotty Moore's iconic guitar playing.
I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true. I'm hoping and I'm praying as my heart breaks right in two. Walking the floor over you. Oh, pick it out, Smitty.
And, it, of course, he was one half of the vocal influences on Hank Williams. This is really where honky-tonk music gets its start, with artists like Floyd Tillman and people like that, Merle Travis coming in after. So he's really big for that reason. And, of course, he also has the connection of being the original performer of Blue Christmas. He also did a version of I Love You Because that Elvis did later. So, yeah, he definitely is a big part of the Elvis story in that sense. You also have Red Foley, who even more of a figure in this kind of way of being an Elvis influence, also started around the same, like, you know, mid-40s, late-40s period. He ended up actually doing a lot of duet records with Ernest Tubbs. That's why I bring him up now. And he drew from a lot of, you know, the R&B, blues, and gospel side of things. And so he had these songs like the Chattanooga Shoeshine Boy, Tennessee Saturday Night. He had all these what was called country boogie songs. So it's like the boogie early R&B songs.
Their music is a fiddle and a crack guitar. They get the kicks from an old fruit jar. They do the boogie to an old square dance. The woods are full of couples looking for romance. Somebody takes his brogan, knocks out the light. Yes, they all go native on a Saturday night.
It's probably shocking for people who have only heard maybe later, more friendly type material, but Red Foley did this very hard-edged R&B type material early in his career, and of course Elvis ended up doing songs that he popularized, like Old Shep and Peace in the Valley. And of course Bill Monroe, being the inventor of bluegrass at that time, is another major figure for inventing a whole subgenre with Earl Scruggs and Lester Flatt and his band. And he had a song called Rocky Road Blues that a lot of people have cited as being one of the first rock songs, including Carl Perkins. Carl Perkins, when someone asked him what rockabilly was, he said that it was the black music, like the blues and R&B, mixed with gospel, and Bill Monroe was what he said specifically. not country music, Bill Monroe. So Rocky Road Blues being what the example that he gave when he said that.
Now the road is rocky, but it won't be rocky long, long, long. Now the road is rocky, but it won't be rocky long. Another man has got my woman in gone.
shining. Shine on the moon that's gonna let me blue. I say blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the moon that's gonna let me blue.
So it's interesting how these are all artists that are performing in kind of different veins from each other. That, you know, what Roy Acuff is playing is very different than what Ernest Tubb is playing, is very different from what Bill Monroe is playing. And yet they're all under the banner of country music. And yet you have these people coexisting, like Bob Wills and Ernest Tubb and people like that. And it's just amazing to me that, you know, there's this huge amount of diversity, and yet we're still calling it country music. Of course, some of these genres got broken off later, like bluegrass eventually didn't have a place in the country radio anymore. Right. But at that time it did. It was just part of the mix. And this is the mix that Elvis is kind of coming into when he's a kid and he's listening to the Grand Ole Opry for the first time. He would have been hearing all these people. Another one that we kind of forgot to mention, but he got his start around the same time, is Eddie Arnold. I mean, Eddie Arnold really is I would say the main figure that Elvis kind of keeps coming back to over his life, whether it's he was recording Eddie Arnold songs in every decade of his career. And Eddie Arnold got his start at the same time. And he was kind of the artist that was vying for the same position that Hank Williams was. Because, I mean, we haven't talked about Hank Williams a lot, but I think a lot of people know about him.
I was just about to get there.
Yeah. But Eddie and Hank were kind of the two sides of the, you know, of the coin in the late 40s. Because after you have Ernest Tubb pioneering honky-tonk and Bill Monroe pioneering bluegrass, you have Hank Williams come in and just completely shatters everything that came before him with how brilliant and incisive his mm-hmm. writing is, and that he creates this whole new stereotype and model for country singers to work off of. That there are literally people that were out there like George Jones who were looking to Hank Williams and saying, that's what I want to be like. I want to be this, you know, hard drinking, rambling, great songwriting, great singer, you know, straight to the bone. And Hank Williams, again, you know, he covered all the stuff that we're talking about. I mean, he wasn't just the drinking songs. He had songs about, you know, mother and home, like the Carter family, and gospel songs. And, you know, he had this diversity to him. He had a blues background, just like Bill Monroe did. So there's a lot of things going on with Hank that do tie back to what we've already talked about. But it's his writing that creates this whole new paradigm in country music, and that ends up becoming a new era in country.
Yeah. But and one thing that happens too is, because you mentioned, you know, them tuning into the Grand Ole Opry, but the other thing that happens is that the Louisiana Hayride gets started. Yes. And we did an episode on the Louisiana Hayride earlier this year. So if folks want to go back and hear a lot more of that, you can certainly do so separately. But the Louisiana Hayride is where Hank Williams comes out of. And he ends up, because it's interesting, in terms of actual records that are coming out, Eddie Arnold is out there first. And often because he lasted so much longer, I've always mentally sort of categorized him as being like after Hank Williams. But he was actually out there before. I mean, parallel with, but he was actually putting out records before Hank. And like you said, they were very much vying for sort of that same position of huge influence, and they both did in their own way. And Eddie ended up sort of taking a different route than Hank in a number of major, major ways. Talking about that blues influence on Hank, of course, you know, you've got a lot of those early proto-rockabilly songs like Move It On Over and I'm a Long Gone Daddy. And to the big one that I think sticks out for me is Lovesick Blues. And the reason why that sticks out for me is that here you have country singer doing a cover of a then 27-year-old show tune that was a pop song back in the day. And
yeah,
it has echoes to me of a lot of what Elvis did, where he's just doing old songs, you know, that people haven't really looked at in a while, and giving it a new twist.
And ever since she's gone away,
I've got those lovely blues, got the feeling all the blues. Since my sweetie said goodbye, seems I don't know what to do. All I do is sit and cry. That last long day we spent alone, why I'm yearning for it yet. Say she thrill me, fill me with a kind of loving I never will forget.
Yeah, and of course, when you go back and you listen to Emmett Miller was the one that kind of had the recording that Hank is working off of, you can hear how similar it is, but also that, you know, Hank definitely adds a certain Rodgers vocal kind of yodel type thing to it.
I got a feeling called a blue. Since my mama said goodbye, it seems I don't know what to do, do, do. All I do is sit and cry.
I mean, Emmett Miller, his version is really similar to Hank's, and I think that Hank always kind of felt like Lovesick Blues wasn't that good. Like I remember reading somewhere that he had just kind of gotten sick of it at a certain point because he just felt like it wasn't like the best thing that he had done or that he hadn't written it or whatever. But I mean, he really did, like you said, you know, he shed light on something that had been kind of dormant for a couple of decades and just breathed this incredible new life into it. And what Hank Williams really needed was an absolute smash hit to get his career going. And that's exactly what he got with that song, that he had been kind of piddling around and trying to get something to work prior to that, and nothing had really worked.
Right.
But once Lovesick Blues came out, he literally became Mr. Lovesick Blues, was what he was referred to on posters and stuff. I mean, it was incredible.
Lord, I love to hear her when she called me sweet daddy, such a beautiful dream. I hate to think it all over, I've lost my heart, it seems. I've grown so used to you somehow. Well, I'm nobody's sugar daddy now, and I'm lonesome. I got the lovesick blue.
And on the flip side of that, Eddie Arnold begins to, as his career goes along, he starts to adopt a little bit more of a pop-oriented sound. And we're definitely going to talk a lot more about Eddie Arnold as we get into talking about Elvis in the 1960s, because that's where I think the biggest influence on Elvis starts to seep in. Take, for instance, a song like I'll Hold You in My Heart, which Elvis would get around to covering later on, but you listen to Eddie Arnold's original version from the 40s, and you hear so many of the elements that we've talked about over the course of this episode, and right up front, even the Hawaiian steel guitar is there. And yet, vocal-wise, while it is a little twangy, there's still a little bit of that pop influence coming in as well.
I'll hold you in my heart till I can hold you in my arms like you've never been held before. I'll think of you each day, and then I'll dream the night away till you are in my arms once more.
But there was certainly, I think, the most obvious influence on Elvis Presley, the fact that Colonel Parker was his manager.
Absolutely. And this is just something that, you know, amazes me, just how, to me, Hank Snow and Eddie Arnold are two of the biggest influences on Elvis that I can tell just from my own listening. And then the fact that there's this Tom Parker crossover going on here is just remarkable and mind-boggling. But yeah, Eddie had this whole thing where he did songs that were these very soft, romantic type songs, and it didn't have all the blues influence of Hank Williams and all that. And he just kind of comes off as this like fairly kind of soft, romantic type guy that you wouldn't necessarily be worried about if you got in a fight with, like Hank Williams or something. And to me, Colonel Tom seems like a very strange match to this guy, because it's like, okay, Colonel Tom has this whole kind of crassness and brash, carny kind of sensibilities. And apparently, according to my memory, at least of researching, that was part of the problem that led to their split, was that right. their personalities just did not work together.
They didn't quite meet eye to eye.
Yeah. And so, yeah, even the idea when you're listening to Eddie Arnold of, like, can you imagine Tom Parker being this guy's, you know, manager? Like, this doesn't seem to make sense. It did eventually come to a head, but... Eddie Arnold, I wanted to point out, when he first started out, he was referred to as the singing plowboy. So he did have this whole, like, fabricated authenticity thing going about him. But but one day he was being dressed up in tuxedos, and he seemed a lot happier with that.
Uh-huh.
And we'll get... We'll get to that in the 1960s.
I mean, and that, when you even compare, like, he did Cattle Call in 1944, like, right at the beginning of his career, and then you go back and you compare the re-recording he did in 1955, they're worlds apart, even though it's literally the same song.
Yep.
The cattle are prowling, coyotes are howling, way out where the dog is born. Whispers are the jingling, a cowboy is singing this lonesome cattle call. Coyotes are howling, way out where the dog is born. Whispers are a jingling, a cowboy is singing this lonesome cattle call.
Eddie would pave the way with songs like I Really Don't Want to Know and It's a Sin and You Don't Know Me.
Anytime, that's a great one.
Yeah, again, it's going to start to become an influence on Elvis in the 60s and 70s.
Right.
Hank, on the other hand, coming up through the Louisiana Hayride and then tragically passing away at such a young age in the early 50s, leaves a gap in country music. There is no country superstar to fill his place at that point.
Right. Hank Williams' death seems almost inevitable when you look at the way that country music develops, because his death is really a moment where country music had a choice of where to go after that. And country music was never the same, because prior to Hank Williams, you had these different strains of the, you know, honky tonk and the soft country of Eddie Arnold and the, you know, the bluegrass and all that stuff. And then after Hank Williams dies, there's this confusion moment, like you talked about, where it's like, what is going to happen next? And that is where the rockabillys come in, kind of swoop into the picture at that point in 1954 and 5. Yeah, I mean, and of course, we have to kind of go further back to the country boogie artists are really where this is kind of the proving ground, so to say, for this kind of music is starting to bubble, because
yes.
A lot of people don't know this type of music at all, or that it even exists. But early R&B by the likes of, like, Louis Jordan or Winoni Harris, Roy Brown, the honkers and shouters, as Arnold Shaw called them. This was the early days of R&B where you had, you know, guys blasting on saxophones and barrel house piano players and these guys that had these big, loud and manly voices singing about cars and women and stuff like that. And, you know, this kind of thing did not just totally, you know, bypass country music. And a lot of people seem to think it did, but it did not. Country music was affected by that. And there's an entire subgenre that was huge back in the late 40s and early 50s called country boogie, and I kind of referred to it earlier with Red Foley, but Red Foley was one among many of people doing stuff like this. I mean, you had the Delmore Brothers, and you had Moon Mullican was a huge one, and so these people are taking the R&B of the time and playing the country instrumentation or even the R&B instrumentation, and they're doing this type of repertoire and the types of double entendre songs and things like that, and it really is just R&B songs played by country musicians, and this was especially popular, like, on the King record label out of Cincinnati, Ohio. This was something that was basically coming out of the whole honky-tonk, barrel house, piano kind of tradition. And this is where the electric guitar starts really coming into its own, too, because, I mean, it's there on the Bob Wilson Texas Playboy stuff, but, I mean, this is where, like, country boogie guitar gets started right here, and so this is where you have, like, Arthur Boogie Smith playing the boogie-woogie guitar. Those kind of lines, like the Delmore Brothers, you know, Freight Train Boogie, things like that. This becomes the foundation for rockabilly and early rock and roll. And that, again, like, people just think that rockabilly sprung out of nowhere, sprung out of just blues music or R&B, but country music absolutely was a part of that. We're going to talk about how, you know, Sun Records was there and all that too.
And then on the other side of the country boogie, you also have the continuation of Western swing, and that's where you get Bill Haley and his Saddlemen. And I can hear people going, "Saddlemen? I thought they were the Comets."
Across the mighty nation, no matter where you go, in every village restaurant and at the movie show, you'll hear the bands playing the top tune of them all. Just drop a nickel in and hear the jukebox cannonball. It started down in Dixie so many years ago, and then somebody sang the tune upon the radio. Now everybody rides it from spring to early fall. They drop a nickel in and hear the jukebox cannonball.
And yeah, as you alluded to that earlier, Bill Haley came out of Western swing music, and a lot of his earliest recordings are this amazing blend of country and rhythm and blues and pop. And I pulled just a few clips here that I'll dribble throughout this part of the discussion, but, like, he rewrote Wabash Cannonball as the Jukebox Cannonball. He did a cover of Ike Turner and Jackie Brenston's Rocket 88.
You women have heard of jalopies, you heard the noise they make, let me introduce you to my Rocket 88. Yes, it's great, just one way. Everybody likes my Rocket 88. Cows will ride in style, moving all along.
And there's a great one that I love just for how strange it is, but how well it works. A cover of Glenn Miller's Chattanooga Choo Choo, which, when you listen to it, it's really hard to argue that the guitar stuff in there is just not up, like, straight up rock and roll guitar solo.
There's gonna be a certain party at the station, satin and lace, I used to call funny face. She's gonna cry until I tell her that I'll never roam. So Chattanooga choo-choo, won't you choo-choo me home?
That early time for Bill Haley really says a lot about a lot of the things that we've been talking about in terms of the different influences happening, because You can totally hear the Western swing. You can hear the country music. You can hear the R&B. You can hear the jazz influence too. I mean, it's the Louis Jordan kind of sound. It's all there in Bill Haley. And once you realize that, like, the Rock Around the Clock and all that is still kind of in that vein, the Western swing meets Louis Jordan, you know, kind of thing, it's just obvious once you hear it that they're just shifting the instrumentation and beat a little bit.
And so then we arrive at the Memphis Recording Service, and Sam Phillips begins recording primarily black acts, you know, as we talked about, Jackie Brenston, Ike Turner, B.B. King, Rufus Thomas, Howlin' Wolf, famously the Prisoners, but also country musicians.
Yeah, and Sam wasn't a huge country person. I mean, he was well known for being basically just a lover of what he called the gut bucket blues. He liked anything that was very raw and gritty and didn't have... I mean, he just, all his life, was passionate about feeling in music, and that he thought that if music didn't have a feel, that it wasn't worth anything. And for him, the poor hardscrabble black blues artists were just the artists that had the most feeling of anybody that he heard. And I'm sure that he was the type of guy that he had been very much exposed to country his entire life. I mean, I read Peter Gronlich's book about him, and of course, you know, it does talk about those early years for him. And as we've been talking about, a lot of country music at that time, it wasn't necessarily so much about passion and the, you know, vocals and all that sometimes, but you would have people like Sarah Carter or Roy Acuff who were passionate. And I think that he just really responded to the immediacy of black music, of R&B and blues. And so when he started his label, or he started really not the label, but the recording service, he was really just trying to create a space where he could create the kind of music that he liked, because he wanted there to be a way for these people to get recorded and heard. And so he set up the recording service so that he could just kind of lord over it and be able to actually have these people come in. And it became a situation where people like Ike Turner or B.B. King were able to come in and record for the first time, and also bring people that they knew in, like, you know, Howlin' Wolf or whoever. And so you have this incredible, you know, kind of center point in Memphis, where now suddenly people like Rufus Thomas or Joe Hill Lewis or B.B. King are able to actually walk in somewhere to record kind of to their heart's content. And then Sam is able to try to turn it into a business by selling whatever recordings he makes to, you know, the Chess Brothers.
Chess Records, yeah.
And you know, there was a lot of small R&B labels at the time, and I guess Sam just didn't really have much of a concept of trying to do that at that point, that he could just sell the recordings. But he did have some country acts on, including one that you sent me that I couldn't believe. I'm sure I had heard this before, but I just completely forgot it. A guy named Hard Rock Gunter, which, I mean, just his first name is foreshadowing if I've ever seen it. But Hard Rock Gunter, Gonna Dance All Night, which is a song that actually includes the lyrics, "We're gonna rock and roll while we dance all night." And that's not just like a lyric, it's the hook of the song. And yeah, it's a country song sung by a guy named Hard Rock, who sounds like Jerry Lee Lewis before Jerry Lee Lewis.
You gather around, friends, and let me tell you what to do. We got a little tune we'd like to play for you. When that rhythm starts, you can't stand still. It'll make you want to dance, and I know that you will. First you listen to the rhythm, then you shuffle your feet. Play a little boogie boogie just to make things right. We're going to rock and roll while we dance all night. Come on, let's dance.
And this is, so Elvis's That's All Right is famously Sun 209. This is Sun 201. It's that close in proximity to Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
And similarly, I pulled a couple other records from in that string just before That's All Right. You know, and you've got Harmonica Frank doing Rockin' Chair Daddy, and it's down and dirty blues, but there's just a little edge of Bob Wills that you hear in there, you know. And I think there's even a little reference where he kind of like goes up into falsetto like Bob did.
started rocking on the way, started rocking on her own. She takes my rocking, and I can't keep you at home.
Lord, Lord.
And then, of course, the Starlight Wranglers and Doug Poindexter. And this is where, of course, Scotty Moore and Bill Black come from.
I call my baby and I ask her for a date. I want to show you the difference in love and hate. Meet me on the corner and don't come formal. We're going on a love and free. I hope you like my kind of care at all.
And yep. Their songs, not so rock.
No. It always surprises me when I listen to it that Sam even, like, recorded those or put it out. It's just, it's not even really up to par with the kind of stuff that he was doing at the time. I'm not just talking about it being country music. It's just, yeah, not one of the best things he ever did. But, of course, it's very historically interesting and, of course, a hugely collectible record now for that reason.
And then we arrive, the summer of 1953, the first days of 1954, when Elvis drops in and records a little demo acetate of My Happiness and That's When Your Heartaches Begin to pop songs. And then he returns and he records two country songs. One is It Wouldn't Be the Same Without You by Al Rogers and the Rocky Mountain Boys originally.
Those familiar old places would just make me blue, 'cause it wouldn't be the same without you.
I've wasted my life on a careless romance, but I do it again, if I had the chance.
And then I'll Never Stand in Your Way, which is originally a pop recording by Joni James, but it was co-written by Fred Rose of Rose Acuff.
Someone new who means more than me to you, I'll never stand in your way.
If you feel we must part, don't let pity rule your heart. I'll never stand in your way.
I don't think I ever realized that. It just blew my mind.
Yeah. Yeah.
Didn't realize that was a Fred Rose.
Yeah, so much so that that when Ray Charles put out his second volume of modern sounds in country and western music, it's on there.
If you've found someone new who means more than me to you, well, I'll never stand in your way.
And so from very nearly the beginning, we hear the direct influence of country music. Now, obviously, we know from the fact that, like, Blue Moon of Kentucky and, like, everything else, the text of everything else, that there's that country influence. But he chose two country songs, or two songs with deep country DNA on them, for a private demo. And what do you yeah. make of those? Because we hear a lot of people talk about My Happiness and That's When Your Heartaches Begin, because they're so pivotal and so important. And there's the fact that he went back to That's When Your Heartaches Begin because he loved Bill Kenny and the Inkspots and just continued to adore their music for the rest of his life. But what do you think of these other two songs? Because I don't think these get talked about as much.
Yeah, these are truly two songs that, like, I barely even remember that they're, like, they exist until, like, I'll put on a Boy from Tupelo or something and be like, I always forget about these. And that's just kind of how I feel about them, is that, I mean, they're kind of forgettable. And I mean, they're not, you know, they're not some of the best country material he ever did or anything like that. But it is just interesting, like you said, to see that some of the first stuff that he goes to just and it's got to be a part of that conversation, because like you said, people do talk about how, you know, one of the very first things that he tries out is like the ink spots and whatnot, which, you know, of course that's important. But again, people are kind of missing this part of the story where one of the first things that just comes to his mind that he wants to do when given like possibly his one shot to make a record is country material. Of course, you know, when you were talking with I hate myself because I can't think of the author's name, The Walk a Lonely Street.
Tony.
Yeah, Tony. Yes, thank you. Yes. Yeah. So when you're talking with Tony about that book, you know, of course, you know, he gave a lot of credit to Elvis kind of being like a good chooser of his material and of, you know, like his view of That's All Right, Mama, and how Elvis did that really blew my mind. And so I think that Elvis was kind of working on a different plane of knowing himself and knowing what material worked best and whatnot. But he was also working in a vein where he was really trying for this whole soft ballad singer kind of thing right at the beginning. And you could tell that he thought of himself as being somebody that was going to sing these very light, airy type ballads. And I think that that was just, he was probably just trying to pick stuff that fit that, you know, milieu for him.
I think the last one to touch upon for, I guess this is going to be a five-parter. Before we wrap this particular part of the discussion, is I Love You Because, which was a Leon Payne recording from 1949. And it's the first country song that we have a proper full quality studio recording of Elvis doing from July 1954.
Try to do. You're always there to lend a helping hand, dear. I love you most of all because you're you. No matter what world may say about me, I know your love will always see me through.
Not to disparage I Love You Because as a song at all. I mean, Leon Payne was the guy who wrote that song. I had to guess that Elvis would have known that version, or maybe Ernest Tubbs was out at that point.
Right.
But it's definitely a good song. So what I see in that is that Elvis knew a good song when he heard it, and he knew that it wasn't like a number one or anything like that, but he knew that it was, you know, okay, here's a song that was a big hit maybe like 5 years ago, and people still know it and like it, and I can do this one, and it kind of fits my ballad singing. So I think that he knew what he was doing in the sense that he knew it was a good song, but it also just wasn't the right thing that Sam was looking for, and it also wasn't the voice that Elvis was going to suddenly hit on in that time either.
Yeah. But then they did hit upon it, and country music would never be the same.
Yeah, we've worked our way from 1923 and back up to 1954, and talk about a explosion that would almost make country music itself die.
I think we're going to continue this in part two, and we'll pick it up with Elvis's first single. Thank you everyone for taking a listen to this, and hopefully you're enjoying, and Garrett and I will be back for part two, I guess. So I believe it's a hot time in Florida
and a rainy night in Georgia.
Jimmie, how about a little music? I don't know, Sarah. You know, I've had the blues all day. I guess you got no business with the blues unless you can sing them. You help me sing this old T for Texas thing, huh?
All right.
T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Texas, T for Tennessee. T for Thelma, that gal that made a wreck out of me.
You've been listening to the TCB Cast, an unofficial Elvis fan podcast.
Someone must have stomped on his head with those blue suede shoes.
Thank you and good night.